All right, we are so excited. We have learned how we make ATP. And we had said that you can even make ATP from proteins, right? But we said, we gotta do something with that darn nitrogen. So we have to cut that thing off. So right here, this nitrogen-containing portion, we've gotta remove it. And then it leaves us with carbons and hydrogens and oxygens, which we know can enter into the processes of cellular respiration. So on slide 8, we talk about deamination. That just means cutting that thing off. And so we cut that thing off, and what does it do? If it's in water, it picks up some more hydrogens and it becomes ammonia. You ever sniffed a bottle of ammonia? Oh, whew. That, you know, it's like smelling salt, wakes you up. It's awful. It's poisonous. That's why it's awful. So if you're gonna make energy from a protein, you're gonna be making a whole lot of toxic chemicals. So what does your body do? I mean, what's a boy to do? What's a person to do, right? What is a person to do? Well, what they do is you make it less toxic. Mm-hmm. So we have something called amination is adding an amine, or if you go from, you know, deamination plus an amination somewhere else, it's called transamination. So what we do is you cut the thing off, you deaminate it, and then you aminate something else. And what do you make? Pee-pee. Mm-hmm. Urine. Urea, to be exact. Urea and uric acid. Urea is toxic and uric acid is toxic, but not nearly as toxic as that ammonia. So it's a way to deal with the toxic byproduct of protein metabolism. That's what you're making, is your urea and uric acid. So if you look on slide number 9, we talk about this whole transamination process. We cut it off of, it means we deaminate the protein and then we aminate something else. And what does that do? It makes urea. And this whole process of making urea is called the ornithine cycle. So that is how you deal with this toxic byproduct of protein metabolism. Now, speaking of metabolism, we all hear these words, metabolic rates, you know, the things like that. We've heard those a million times. And so we had this thing called the basal metabolic rate. And this is the rate of metabolism when you're sitting, kind of like I am, sitting comfortably. Maybe I'm a little above basal metabolic because I'm jumping around and stuff. But if I was just sitting and relaxing, but not asleep, my metabolic rate would be what you would refer to as my basal metabolic rate. Now, your minimal metabolic rate occurs when you're asleep, so it's lower than your basal metabolic rate. Now, but hopefully during the day, you're not just always in your basal metabolic rate, right? There are times where you are busy and you are doing stuff and things are happening. And so during a 24-hour period, you would have a total metabolic rate. And that consists of your basal metabolic rate plus those times when you're doing stuff. And so the basal metabolic rate for a human is about 2,000 calories per day. But even a person who isn't very active burns maybe 2,500 calories a day in their total metabolic rate. If you are a workaholic, if you are a professional athlete or a sheep shearer, believe it or not, I saw numbers on them and they, you know, it's kind of like a sheep wrestler. If you ever had sheep, you know, they don't really want to be sheared. And they're about as big as you are. So anyway, they burn huge amounts of energy. But like, probably you can relate more closely to an athlete, a professional athlete. They might burn as much as 5,000 to 7,000 calories a day. They can eat candy bars all day and never gain an ounce. Okay. We have one small portion left to talk about. And this has to do with molecules that are found in your body that are used to carry fats. Now, so if we've all along we've said that your blood consists mostly of water and it's polar. So it will dissolve polar substances very readily, right? But when you just think about when you eat a steak or cheese or something with a lot of fat in it, you gain weight. So there must be some way for that non-polar substance, the lipids, to make it to the fat cells or to your liver and then eventually to your fat cells. Well, it ends up that when you're in your capillaries that are associated with your digestive tract, where you're absorbing nutrients into the bloodstream, we have these little capillaries where the lipids will be put into a little membrane ball. It's called a chylomicron, and that is carrying the fat in this water environment, which we had said isn't hospitable for transporting fats. So we have chylomicrons that are carrying the lipid products from your digestive tract to your liver. Now, in your liver, if you have excess fat and you need to do something with it, what do? You put it in a fat cell. And so you say, oh, well, fat cells, they're kind of around my belly, right? So you have them in various places in your body, but they're not, you know, it's not in your liver. They have to be taken there. So in your liver, what happens is that fat that you digested and that was brought there in the chylomicron, it gets put into another little vesicle. It's called a very low density lipoprotein. That's what they call it. So it's the VLDL. And this VLDL is going to be carrying the fat to the fat cells. And so it bubbles along in the circulatory system until it gets to the fat cell. It puts the fat in the fat cell, and what's left behind is a little bit of cholesterol. Mm-hmm. What do you worry about? When you go to the doctor and they draw blood and they check for lipoproteins, you worry about low-density lipoproteins. I haven't mentioned them yet. I mentioned the very low-density lipoproteins. We're not talking about those. After the very low-density lipoprotein gives up its fat to a fat cell, it becomes a low-density lipoprotein, and that is a little packet carrying cholesterol, and that's the bad cholesterol. Okay, so that can build up in your arteries, right? Well, it ends up, we have one more kind of a little packet that's out there, and it's a high-density lipoprotein. And it doesn't have cholesterol in it. It's a little packet that is there to pick up stray cholesterol. And so it floats around and picks up stray cholesterol and removes it from your blood. So that's why they call it the good lipoproteins. The HDL is helping clean up all of that cholesterol that builds up in your circulatory system. Okay, so we have. How do you control this? Well, basically, you can help. So we have this ratio. Spit it out, Steve. We have this ratio between the LDL and the HDL. If you get your blood work done, they want to have a higher HDL versus the LDL, and that's what you're going for, and that's because the HDL is cleaning out your system, kind of like the Roto-Rooter maybe, you know. So, but other than that, how can you change this ratio? And it's basically exercise. Mm-hmm. Nothing in life comes easy, right? It's basically exercise. All right, so we have one final piddly little slide I'm going to talk about right now, and we've all heard that bran is good for you. Mm-hmm. So it ends up, what is in bran? Fiber. But not all fiber is created equal. It ends up bran does have oat bran, it's the covering on the seed, but anyway, oat bran, it does have a lot of what we call water-soluble fiber, pectin, and that is good. That will help lower your cholesterol level. Now, in addition to that, there's other kinds of fibers that they used to think, all fibers were great. They're going to help with your cholesterol. Well, it ends up, these other ones, the water-insoluble dietary fiber, it's sort of wood that happens to be in your food. It doesn't do anything for you. So anyway, hey, we have come to the end of today's lecture. Woohoo! I've got to go teach a lab here in about 30 minutes. So you guys have a good day.